for using gathering techniques, and for the high probability to include noisy cells in the device. In addition, crosstalk is an issue, and the possibility of again including bad cells leads to a yield with this which is not 100%, of course, and most importantly uniformity of the detector. Also, the large number of cells affect the signal shape and this is affecting the choice of the electronics, which can be either integrated or external. So I will try to illustrate how these issues are addressed and was partially solved in this last 15 years. It will not, of course, an historical representation of this process, and well, it's responding slowly. Sorry, it is stuck. In fact, so this is not an historical review. I will concentrate on the. Oops. On the most recent developments. Now something is going wrong here. I don't know what you are seeing now. Okay. So nowadays, there are two possibilities that were developed for having these arrays working. And one is the analog signal. One is, in fact, the so-called analog silicon photomultiplier, which is essentially putting together many cells in parallel and is providing a single analog signal, including the information of time and amplitude. And the other possibility is the digital silicon photomultiplier, where essentially any cell has its own amount of transistors for control and for propagating the signal, so that the information is in output is much more, can be much more detailed. Different technologies for silicon processing, let's say, are implemented there, and I will try to illustrate this in the next slides. But before, I should say that on the market nowadays there are many devices available, and there is a large competition among institutions and manufacturers, and especially for the analog silicon PM, there is a large choice, and the prices are getting lower and lower. Let's say the asymptotically, we should reach a level of 10 euros per centimeter square. Concerning the choice, we have a lot of monolithic devices which allow to be sensitive to 1 centimeter in 1 centimeter of the order of 1 centimeter active surface. Of course, they can be arranged in arrays, either discrete or monolithic. And concerning the spectral sensitivity, there is a large choice also for devices covering from the vacuum ultraviolet to the near infrared photon sensitivity. Especially for the analog photomultiplier, silicon PM, there is a large possibility of customization. And so we will discuss it later. Now, from the point of view of technological aspects, there are two fundamental possibilities to implement cells and arrays of cells. One is exploiting custom processes. You see here an example of implementation for the shallow junction APD cell. Here you see also, you see the most important regions, which are, first of all, the optical window with possibly anti-reflective coating for optimal absorption of the photons of interest. Then an active volume, which is essentially a drift region with low electric field and a very high field region where the avalanche is developing. A third very important region is the border region, where the presence of a guard ring is fundamental for preventing edge breakdown and for insulation of the cells. And in addition, for additional insulation between the cells, a trench usually is implemented there. Now, in the next slide, you see the border region in a simulation, in a TCAD simulation for a custom process. You see the border region is very critical because of the definition of the of, let's say, the active area, and because I have impact on also on the noise which can be developed, especially where some mechanical let's say trenches are implemented. There is a large possibility of tuning the performances in the custom process, which is not the same at the moment for the CMOS process, which is, by the way, allowing for different possibilities, like implementing dedicated electronics integrated. The important regions here also are, of course, the optical stack region, but even more important, both a guard ring and an STI insulation trench, and of also in the bottom, it's very important to insulate with the barrier layer. Insulation is very important also for the electronics. In the last few years, there was a very important development also of this kind of cells, for obvious reasons, and especially from the point of view of CMOS process, this was enabled by the possibility of the high voltage extension, which is quite diffuse and common. As I told you, concerning the custom technology, there is a much larger possibility for tuning the intrinsic parameters, like the photo detection efficiency or the dark rate can be reduced or tuned, and in general performances can be let's say are a little bit better. On the other hand, by the way, integrated electronics in the CMOS technology enable for very detailed information extraction, very fast timing, so these two, I will try to illustrate some of these aspects in the rest of the talk. Still concentrating now on the working principles, let's say, of these two different technologies. So essentially, concerning the analog silicon PM, you have a passive cell which needs essentially a resistor for quenching the avalanche, and also very importantly for recharging the cell. In addition, you put together, you arrange in parallel the diodes, and this same resistor allow the coupling of them. Now, this is a very simple concept, but it's quite tricky to implement. In fact, there is a trade-off due to contrasting constraints. And from one end, you have to, have provide a large value for resistor for quenching the avalanche and pushing the bias voltage below the breakdown. And the level of the current should be accordingly quite low, below a so-called latching level. On the opposite, on the other end, you have also to provide recharging and possibly quick recharging of the cell, which call for smaller resistor. So it's a trade-off. From the point of view of the signal, essentially this kind of device is essentially current source with some mostly capacitive output impedance, which usually is read out by low input impedance electronics. We will come back to this point very soon. Now, as I said, you put in parallel many cells, from hundreds to thousands of them, and you sum essentially a number of binary signals due to number of photons which are converting in the cells, and the sum of these signals, of these binary signals, is resulting in an analog signal proportional to the number of photons. It's a linear response up to a certain extent, proportional to the number of photons. Now, from the point of view of the CMOS, so the digital silicon PM, the quenching and recharge of the diode is provided by transistor, essentially. So it's controlled by a feedback loop, which is quenching the cell when the voltage you pick up in this node is exceeding some threshold. This is a very fast way for operating the cell, which allow for developing a low amount of charge, and it's very interesting because of potentially provide less noise, dark noise, and after pulsing, and so on, but also because you are able to select and to disable, let's say, faulty cells. It has to be reminded that almost a very large fraction of dark noise is due to a low fraction of cells. So in addition, of course, due to the possibility of having the electronics nearby processing this digital signal, you have much more information available. So you can see here the Philips implementation of this digital silicon PM, where you see that, of course, the transistor are reducing the so-called fill factor, that is the fraction of the active area, because of obvious reasons. And we will see later how this can be bypassed. So now we will concentrate on the analog silicon PM mostly, essentially, for illustrating some of the most important parameters and performances. So I will start with discussing the gain, then we will go to photo detection efficiency, timing, and finally the different kind of noise sources that are involved. So gain and path shape. Now, as I anticipated, essentially the cell is, the signal you get from one single cell is due to the discharge, the fast discharge of a capacitor, and this is providing an internal current which is filtered through passive elements, provided by the capacitance of the cells themselves. And so you have an external current, which is first a filtered version of the internal one. And then when the avalanche is quenched, it is due to the recharging of the cell. So the gain is provided mainly by the capacitance of the cell multiplied by the overvoltage, so the potential the bias in excess from the breakdown. The pulse shape is, in first approximation, an exponential rise and exponential fall, falling signal, and gain is essentially linear with the overvoltage if the device is fully depleted when biased above breakdown. There is no multiplication noise, so very well defined gain with very well defined fluctuation and small fluctuation, so no multiplication noise, and gain is mostly independent of temperature. Rise time is also related to some parameters of the cells, essentially the internal resistance, which is independent of temperature, while the recovery time can be a long tail, essentially depending on the quenching resistance. And this can be strongly dependent on temperature, and we will go back. You can see here on the top right of the picture a waveform illustrating single photoelectron pulses, double pulses due to essentially this is a dark environment, so this is crosstalk between two cells, and also train soul pulses, which is essentially after pulses. The spectrum of photoelectrons amplitude is on the bottom left. You can see that the single electron can be seen very well, and you can see here on the right the bias voltage, the gain versus bias voltages, which is quite linear in case of full depletion, of course. Now the fluctuation on the gain related essentially to few factors. One of the main most important factors is the uniformity of the doping profiles all around the silicon, all around the cells, which is quite under control, and especially in the latest years, techniques for tuning the electric field profile internally to the cell were developed for improving the uniformity of the breakdown voltage, essentially, all over the silicon PN. So you can see the evolution in concerning the spread of the breakdown voltage here, right on the bottom, and so nowadays, the order of magnitude of the breakdown voltage spread, and so the gain essentially spread is very well below 100 millivolts or so. Now, in principle, this is an optimal photon counting detector with a perfect energy resolution, but there are, of course, limiting factors. In particular, for the counting mode, you can face the fact that there is a finite number of pixels. So when the intensity of light is quite high, you can saturate, and so the response, of course, is no more linear. This can be accounted for, and the only tricky point is that there can be correction to the proportionality to the saturation, to a certain extent. The point is that the dead cells, which cannot be activated by new photons, are recharging in some amount of time, and so the effective let's say the effective linearity is related to also as to take you have to take into account also the recharging time, which has to be compared to the rate of your photons. So, for instance, for calibrating your devices, you have to use light sources where the let's say the light emission profile in time should match, let's say, the final detector light emission in time in order to properly calibrate. Now, even if you correct for saturation, of course, this can be the energy resolution cannot be very good at very high illumination levels. So in the recent years there was a trend in enhancing the dynamic range by putting together. For putting together a large amount of tiny cells. So tiny means 10 to 50 microns or so, and this was a successful trend addressed by many institutions and manufacturers. You can see here an example of some years ago. Essentially, there are a large amount of advantages in using tiny cells, not only for dynamic range, but also less charge is around in the cell, so less after pulsing, less crosstalk, and mitigation of radiation damage, less occupancy essentially, so also photo detection efficiency can be better. And due to the pulse shape, very tiny and short pulse shape, also timing can be better. You can see here some other example by Yamamatsu and then FBK, Fondazione Bruno Kessler. And the most important, the tricky point, of course, is fill factor. If you have a tiny cell, the border region is dominating. And so the trend is, the main issue is to reduce is to go go tiny with a very tiny perimeter passive region. You can see that from, for instance, here at FK, they recently can provide a device with a very high field factor, 60%, even very low dimension. The same for Amamatsu. And finally, very important, as I anticipated, is the pulse shape for this very tiny and short pulse shape, which can, of course, allow high rates and very good time. Now, it's time for discussing a little bit more in detail pulse shape and then go to energy and time measurements with this information. There are a large amount of models which you can find in these references summarized. Essentially, the internals, the internals electric model for the silicon PM is quite complicated, much more than a PMT. There are, you can see the cell here with the quenching resistor and the cell capacitance, then the internal very low resistance here, and there is it's very important to include also parasitics in the cell, so parasitic capacitance in the cell. You have also to distinguish between firing microcells and other microcells here. You can see that are essentially making a passive filter there. And other parasitic inductances should be included. You can see, especially in Marano, in this Marano Kines paper, a very detailed analysis, transient analysis for the rising time, quenching transient, rising transient, quenching transient, and recharge. And I will summarize it, let's say, very briefly. So first of all, the assumption is that fuel cells are firing, and essentially the device has a capacitive behavior. In this case, it's very important for the coupling with the amplifier. In this case, you can either detect the voltage sensed, which is developed essentially in the capacitor, in the device capacitance. High impedance readout, which is essentially used in some cases by exploiting Darlington transistors in high frequency voltage amplifier. But the most exploited scheme is to use a low, very low impedance front-end electronics for reading out the current, which is potentially lower noise, and so transimpedance amplifier with few ohms in resistive in input are very often exposed. So with this additional assumption, and by developing this transient analysis, so low input resistance for the electronics, then one could see that essentially, I will skip some details about this. One can see that essentially the shape of the pulse, the current pulse, is made by two components, made up by two components. One slow, one fast component, which is rising very fast constant, the time constant related to the internal resistance plus the overall cell capacitance. So very, very fast. For the fast component, there is a decay time, which is related to the load resistance time, the total capacitance of the cell. While the long tail, there is a second part, which is slow signal, related to the long tail, related to the quenching resistor, which is quite tight, multiplied by the overall cell capacitance. Now, in this, even with this more sophisticated model, of course, the gain is still well defined, over voltage, time capacitance of the cell. The current peak is essentially related, of course, to the number of photons, to the overvoltage, and is the ratio between the quenching capacitance over the total capacitance and divided by the load resistance. So this can be seen these two components can be separated when you change temperature, because the fast component is independent of temperature, and while the slow component is dependent on it through the quench resistor, which is quite depending on has a large variation with the temperature. So you can see here this effect. So it's very important to say that the current peak is essentially independent of the quenching, but if you integrate or the temperature, but if you integrate the charge, then you have to take into account the variation with temperature of the quenching resistor. Now, different technologies are there for mitigating this variation of the resistor, either the with temperature, either the thin metal film devices or polysilicon devices are there. Polysilicon devices recently evolved in silicon resistive layers, which provide, let's say, less variation with temperature. This is a FDK technology, and now let's say concerning the the possibility of processing the signal and obtaining very good results. I selected an example of from dark side experiment of cryogenic front end electronics, which is based essentially of bipolar junction transistors at the cryogenic temperatures, and essentially transimpedance scheme, which is allowing for obtaining very high signal to noise ratios at low temperatures. Now, it's very interesting the analysis of the signal of the pulse shape and of the noise by Alessandro, illustrated in many papers, Alessandro and colleagues, and essentially, you can see here the pulse shape with the spike, with the long tail, and this is, of course, to be compared with noise. The model of noise is very, also very interesting. There is no time for going into details here, but this is telling that essentially there is the need for filtering in this case at few megahertz, which is allowed by the low rate of the experiment, and overall the final result is that over a very huge area, 24 centimeter square, the single electron, the single photoelectron spectrum is very, very excellent essentially. Now, a second point here is that the specially developed silicon PMs for this application allow for very low noise. We will go back on this later, and very extended range of overvoltage, which allows you essentially to saturate photodetection efficiency by keeping still noise very low. Low noise is, of course, a feature which you can get at very low temperatures, but anyway, overvoltage extension range is quite important. So let's come to photodetection efficiency. In fact, which is depending on a few number of factors. Of course, the transmission of the optical window, the photo generation of the pair inside the active area, the triggering probability for the avalanche, and the geometrical fill factor. Concerning the quantum efficiency, essentially at low wavelengths, you are limited by the transmission of the optical stack, and on the contrary, at large or long wavelengths, you are limited by photon generation inside the silicon. So these two limitations are very. We will go back on this. The shape of the photo detection efficiency is in fact provided essentially not only by the quantum efficiency but also from the probability of triggering, which is quite different for different devices. Essentially, N on P structure is quite different from P on N because different carriers are triggering the avalanches, and so either holes or electrons, and this is coupled with different ionization rate in silicon by electrons and holes. So you can have better sensibility to the blue light with P on N, and on the contrary, you are enhancing red sensibility with N on P. Concerning the evolution of this photodetection efficiency, it was improving in the last few years because of many factors. You can see here some example. One of the crucial factors is, in addition, the field factor. You can see I already discussed a little bit, but essentially the problem is to fine tune the border region. Now, limited amount of dead area, about 1 mile, less than 1 micron, is nowadays possible in the perimeter region. This is very critical because the guard ring is there, and so this area is also functional to the proper working of the device. In the two very important trends in the last few years were to push the sensibility to vacuum ultraviolet region, curing the superficial curing the optical stack, and minimizing superficial recombination is two important points there. You can see that vacuum ultraviolet now devices can reach a very interesting photodetection efficiency at level 20%, concerning near infrared sensibility, this was also, there is a trend for enhancing this by tuning the properties of the device at the border. Again, so you have to absorb photons in the enhance the depth of the devices, but this creates problems at the border, which can be solved, but it is quite tricky. Essentially, you exploit deplete much more at the border, and so the effective field factor, is less, the nominal. There are improvements there, and many manufacturers and institutions are pushing in this direction. You can see some results here with very high photodetection efficiencies at 900 nanometers. With some megahertz level per millimeter square dark noise rate. It's very important to notice that very good figures of merits for judging any kind of silicon PMs are made by photodetection efficiencies versus dark rate or versus noise. This is allowing you for comparing devices in an optimal way. Very briefly, a quite recent possibility for bypassing the problems in enhancing the near infrared sensibility is provided by these spherical junction CPMs, IPMs, which have been developing by Ketech and some colleagues. You can see references here. The first preliminary devices are very interesting in terms of performances. Essentially, the junction is spherical, and you bypass problems at the border effects. Essentially. Now, we this infrared trend is very important for industry too, and especially for LIDAR applications. So there is a strong push. LIDAR is one of the many applications that they involve a very fast timing, and silicon PMs has indeed very good time. So let me discuss briefly timing properties of these devices, which are intrinsically very fast, in fact, due to the very few picoseconds development of the avalanche, with some fluctuation due to the transverse propagation of the avalanche, and some long tails due to deep conversion and let's say delayed avalanches. But essentially, the single microcell can jitter below 20 picoseconds. The problem is when you put together many microcells in a silicon PM, the problem is always there, capacitance, which is quite large, essentially. So you can see that when you have a 3x3 silicon PM, the bottom line is for single photon solution, of course, is 100, let's say, below at the level of, let's say, 100 picoseconds. You can see a very interesting reference there, and I think I have to skip some considerations. The main point is that essentially blue light is in general jittering quite less than red light, also because of deep conversion tails. Then, in order to extract time information properly, of course, you have to work on the pulse shape. And a good point is to have enhanced fast component and time sets, because the shape of the pulse is quite tiny, and the rise time is also very fast. At high frequency, in the models, you have to include also the inductance, which is given, for instance, by parasitics or wirings, and is providing a low pass filter, and also complex conjugated poles, which are leading to ringing of the signal. So the interaction between the inductance and the impedance of the amplifier is very important. By the way, concerning the most relevant limitation, again, there is capacitance. And when you go large, with a large area, the capacitance is quite large. So despite the fact that a single cell is very fast and the tiny devices can be very fast, the main limitation is going larger. And up to a certain extent, you cannot do. And the best thing is to go for active submission of analog signals. The alternative is digital, of course. So here you can find an example of a very good way of putting together actively silicon PMs by the Moon Music ASIC. And I would like to also, concerning let's say single channels, also to provide an example of very fast way for extracting and low noise way for extracting the fast signal by using the balanced unbalanced transformer coupled to voltage high frequency amplifier, which is for instance in TOF PET application very interesting for providing very low jitter at level of below 100 picoseconds. Now, noises in silicon PMs. Essentially, I already introduced them. Primary noise is dark rate due to essentially thermal generation, Shockley-Reed-Hall noise in the high field region, which is enhanced by the high field, in fact. And the second component is vent-to-vent tunnel. Now, it's very important to notice that the thermal component is decreasing very fast with temperature, and you are left with tunneling at low temperature. So in the last last few years, the trend was to engineering the internal high field in order to reduce, minimize the tunneling component. So the so-called low field devices are featuring very, very low level of dark rate, point 0.3 counts per cell at cryogenic temperature. This is very interesting and allowed the results you saw before by DarkSide, for instance. So engineering of the electric field was applied, and essentially lower field extended over a wider high field region was the solution, roughly speaking. Of course, other techniques are important for reducing the dark rate, like scattering techniques and very high quality of the epitaxial layer. Nowadays, we can say that per millimeter squared, 30 kilohertz are a reasonable level of dark. As I told you in advance, there are very few cells that are providing the bulk of the dark rate. So, of course, digital silicon PM is capable of quitting them, is able to improving quite a lot the level of the dark rate. Okay, now correlated noise is essentially due to two kind of effects, carriers that are trapped during the avalanche and then released later, and avalanches, which is after pulsing, and then optical crosstalk, which is essentially related to photons generated during the avalanche and that are triggering new avalanches. You can find many details in my slides that there is no time for discuss in detail. Anyway, both for crosstalk and after pulse, some counter measurements were developed, for instance, for crosstalk by using trenches for separating the cells, and concerning the after pulse, concerning the after pulse, the effective possibility was to reduce to have a better implementation of the passivation process, because because after pulsing is generated essentially by traps at superficial level in the interface here at the window. So improved server passivation got good results concerning the mitigation after pulsing, in order to conclude this part, I'm going to conclude also the talk. In fact, I'm a bit late and I apologize. Radiation hardness is quite important, of course, for many applications. I will briefly say that essentially noises, these different kinds of noises are the main effects that you get when you irradiate your devices, essentially dark rate and correlated noises, but also a reduction of photodetection efficiency due to many cells occupied by the dark rate. As a roughly speaking, silicon PMs are still working at very high, let's say, relatively high dose of neutron per centimeter square, neutron equivalent, one MeV equivalent, 10 to the 14th. By the way, photon counting is lost much earlier at 10 to the 11th. You can have much more detailed information by Yuri's presentation, and there is an additional paper quite recent by Yuri and Erika Garutti. You can see the reference here. Of course, annealing is working properly, and of course also cooling at low temperature is improving. Roughly speaking, tiny cells are a possible solution for mitigating these effects because of less charge developed there, as I told you before, so less gain, less fraction of dead cell due to dark count. Again, cooling, and also due to the traps and defects generated in the interface, the window interface, also a proper processing of that region is very important to mitigate radiation damages. So finally, concerning the applications. You can see here, still in concerning radiation damages, the fiber tracker for the upgrade of LHCb, which is based on Hamamatsu Seiko photovoltaic price. They are working quite standard, I would say, but for mitigating the problem of the relatively high radiation dose at working condition, they will be operated minus 14 degrees. And in these conditions, after irradiation, they overall feature 14 megahertz of dark noise, which is, by the way, producing an inefficiency, let's say occupancy-related inefficiency, at level of 2%, which is quite interesting. Another tracker, this time 3D, is being developed by the T2K experiment, near detector, in order to provide a neutrino active target made by millions of cubes read out in three projections by fibers. This is quite interesting as a new kind of tracker, which will exploit in 60,000 of silicon PMs by Hamamatsu. Concerning crystal calorimetry, my attention was trapped by barium fluoride resurrected, essentially, by the possibility of using silicon photomultipliers in a solar blind configuration. So in order to exploit the 220 nanometers very, very fast peak, and instead rejecting the longer wavelength part of the spectrum of the barium fluoride. This is quite interesting, and developing a dichroic filter on the window of the silicon PMs. Near infrared, I think I have to skip. Near infrared is very important, of course, for LIDAR applications, and there is a strong push and very interesting results, for instance, by Hamamatsu, but also Broadcom, also other companies are pushing that. I would like to focus, by the way, on different use of silk or more standard silk on photon enterprise. First, the time of flight detector in for the MEG 2 experiment were essentially for the first time a series combination of silicon PNs were exploited. Series combination provide essentially less capacitance, so better signal, and this was an interesting trend exploited also by other experiments. Again, still in MEG 2 for the calorimeter, vacuum ultraviolet silicon PMs were developed by Hamamatsu in that case and were combined in a, again, series combination with a special parallel connection for biasing them. Now, this leads me to few considerations concerning the so-called ganging of silicon PM. So how to put them together in order to provide a large surface, first in a passive way, then we will see in an active way. So you can connect them in series. You reduce in this way the capacitance by a factor related to the number of silicon PMs. In principle, you have lower noise, potentially lower noise and higher current signal. And also a fast signal. In addition, you can have an automatic adjustment of the overvoltage by using the dark current itself for polarizing. So you automatically put all the silicon PMs in the same working condition, same overvoltage, independently on the breakdown voltage, in principle. The parallel connection, which was in the past quite the standard, provide in principle higher noise and the signal on a low impedance amplifier is potentially lower, and most importantly, the slow tail of the signal is enhanced, so not good for timing. But also you have to group to select silicon PMs from with the same breakdown voltage. Now this way of putting together silicon PMs, which is called ganging, is simple. You can combine also series and parallels configurations. But at the end of the day, the area is limited. So in order to enhance the area, you have to provide some electronics in order to sum the signals. Again, a beautiful example is provided by the dark side solution, where you have two series and three parallels passive, and then four of them are summed in an active way with the second level of with an additional transient. So dark side, I think I have to skip the details of the experiment, but and also concerning the silicon PMs, I already told you about the very interesting development providing very low noise. This is the ganging solution for the two parallel and times three series. And finally, the summing, the active summing here. Also, the NXO experiment is exploiting cryogenic silicon PMs. They are directly vacuum ultraviolet because of exploiting the liquid xeno scintillation light without any wavelength shifting. They are developing both analog and digital readouts. Concerning the digital readout, this leads me to the final to the conclusion, essentially the talk. This is quite interesting because a special kind of digital silicon PM is being developed by Sherbrooke University and Triumph, which is exploiting essentially biases for bringing the electronics on the back and so enhancing the fill factor of the digital silicon PM. So yeah, you can see here the scheme of what I'm saying. So through silicon via bias at the cell level, which is not at all trivial, it's exploited there for reducing the dead area in the per cell. And this is a trend which is quite recent and not at all trivial for the technology as to be implemented. Yeah, I can see a cross section for this kind of stack with three tiers, tiers essentially. So this leads me to finally the conclusion with some apologies for the time, which went quite fast. So silicon PMs are feature a very high sensitivity from low photon fluxes to very high photon illuminations. They feature even in large areas very good jitter force. Single photoelectron below, let's say, 50 picoseconds, which of course called for proper electronics to be extracted. Single photoelectron noise, can be pushed at the level of some kilohertz. And also correlated noise can be very well contained at the percent level, which is quite good. Still, nowadays the radiation tolerance is not very I would say satisfactory for this kind of devices. But on the positive side, there are many more features like working in very intense magnetic fields or electromagnetic high frequency, let's say, environments. They provide, of course, low bias voltage and very low power consumption. They are quite robust. You can switch on the light and they will not evaporate like the cathode or the photomultiplier and so on. And also the cost is still going low at the level asymptotically to 10 euros per centimeter square. So the impressive processes I tried to illustrate started more or less 15 years ago, and they are quite steady, I would say, and so we expect still very good news in the future from these kind of devices, both the analog and digital. So there are nowadays many projects that are exploiting these new devices, and the trends are for reducing the nuisance features like noise crosstalk and extending the range of the photon sensitivity. It's clear that concerning the noise, the low temperature and cryogenic temperature environment are the best places where to exploit them, also in a very large area configuration like several meters, square meters. Okay, so thanks for your attention and apologize for the long talk. There is a lot of material here concerning also additional types of silicon photomultipliers based on different kind of semiconductor, but I think that we can stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gian Maria, for this complete overview and all the material you have put together. The slides are available on the Indigo, so people will certainly consult them to get more information. Now, we have not much time left, unfortunately, for the discussion now, but if you have a question, please raise your hand and we will follow them. There's one by Felicia. Please go ahead.
Hi, Gian Maria. Felicia.
Hi, ciao Felicia.
I have a question just about the application of the digital CPMs. There are new application in X-rays that needs a fast device. Do you think that it's affordable to realize a digital CPM for X-rays detection?
Yeah, I think so. Of course, let's say it depends on the dimension of cells, for instance, because even for charged trucks, if you have let's say cells like they are now, even 30 microns, then you will have a single many carriers in the cell, which is developing, by the way, just single avalanche. So so there are also trends for developing kind of silicon PMs sensitive to charged trucks, which, by the way, has to face the fact that one truck signal is just like a single photon with very high probability of generating the avalanche and so, but still very, very, I mean, the dark rate is a problem there. I guess that also for X-rays, it could be an issue. But maybe with the tiny cells and the possibility of triggering, which is allowed for in regions, which is allowed for digital silicon PMs, then there is. I think it's affordable. But I confess you, maybe.
Okay, we have four more questions, and this is all we can take. And Gian Maria, you try to be brief in the answer. There's one by Oscar, please.
Yeah, hello. Thank you very much for this nice talk. This is Oscar from France. The question I had was about the high rate capabilities. I mean, very often the papers illustrate that they are fast responses for the silicon PMs. You actually mentioned that. But of course, the long tail makes that you get pileups if you want to operate the silicon PMs at high rates or very high rates. So what would be the most appropriate, circuit to read out the PM in order to reduce the decay time? I mean, of course, this has to do with the quenching resistor. You mentioned also that for the MEG, for example, they connected the silicon PMs in series. So what would be the appropriate approach for high rate capability and not so much for fast timing?
Yeah, let's say double pass still is a matter of pulse shape. So I think that the best choice would be to go very tiny in dimension of the cells, so that the in order to enhance the parasitic capacitance and having these very very short pulses, which are a characteristic of these tiny cells. Then the connection is also helping, so the series connection, which is reducing the capacitance, is helping, and again very fast a very low impedance readout of the current. I think that this will help double pulse resolution, or let's say high rate capabilities, if I correctly understood.
Thank you. Next question.
Thank you.
By Paola.
Yeah. Hi. Thank you for the talk. It was very interesting. I have a curiosity. So earlier this year, I read about black silicon ultraviolet photodiodes. So I was wondering if you could comment something on those, because they seem to be very high in efficiency for VUV photons.
So black silicon, confess you, I associated black silicon to near infrared. So it's a little bit confusing to me, because in the past there were trends for yes, black silicon essentially is surface which enhanced the conversion of by the way near infrared, but maybe solar blind is what you mean, which is something related more, as I very briefly went through, solar blind means this development which was carried for barium fluoride, using essentially exploiting dichroic filters for the on top of vacuum ultraviolet silicon PM. So this is, but I confess you otherwise that. I've not yet.
Okay, it doesn't matter.
Okay, leave it here. Then we have a question of Sergei.
Hi. Could you say, please, something more specific about trends and prospects of silicon PM? I mean, some kind of competition between analog and digital. And inside this two kind, 3D CPM, tiny pixel, analog CPM, I guess it's very interesting and important point what we could expect in a few years.
Yeah, let's say that in fact there are two trends which are quite parallel since many years, and as I tried to illustrate concerning analog, there is a very high possibility for tuning the performances, which was indeed leading the evolution, so photo detection efficiency very high and so on. Of course, in parallel, there were many developments that started again a lot of years ago, and from the SPADA rates and in that case, I guess the optical stack is still can be still an issue, but I see that is being let's say for instance, I think that in LF Foundry in Italy. They developed techniques for enhancing the CMOS quality of the optical stack, for instance. On the other side, of course, the electronics there is fundamental, and this true silicon bias is, at cell level from Sherbrooke University are extremely interesting and will be for sure a trend which will lead us to very interesting devices.
Stop it here, because we have two more questions very briefly, please, because we really have to finish the seminar. Shashank, briefly.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for your talk. Myself, Shashank from Forsaken Tivolish. Just can you briefly comment on limitations of smaller cells in terms of crosstalk, radiative recombination, or lateral diffusion? Or means like what can be the tiny cells we can think of?
Yeah, let's say the as far as I can understand, the main limitation is the is at process level, which in particular for the custom cell is providing a distance to the to the to the from cell to cell at level of a couple of microns, which is now for most of the manufacturers a limitation. I'm not sure that can this can be bypassed, and this is the main limit. So if you think of 5 microns cell, you get let's say that a couple of microns are lost due to this. And by the way, this can be maybe improved. The problem there is to go in deep configuration. So for near infrared, tiny cells looks more tricky than for ultraviolet, let's say. By the way, 5 microns still are there. But again, there are from the past quite interesting example of alternative. Solutions and recently, as I tried to briefly say, illustrate also Sergei's and Ketek solution for these boundary problems, let's say, provided by the spherical junctions could be very, very interesting. So I am looking forward for new developments from
okay.
Them.
Okay, then we have a final question briefly by Massimo, and that is the last one.
Thank you. So, Gian Maria, let me start by congratulating you for the excellent speech. Very, very intriguing also for people working on the subject since ages. I have a couple of remarks. The first one, you have been asked about what you have to do for sustaining high rate. I would say it depends on how high it is high, obviously. I think you should not neglect the possibility to process the signal, for instance, with a pole zero cancellation, which is reducing the duration, the native duration, and for instance, is taking you from standard 5 megahertz counting rate to a sustainable, which is, say, at least reasonable up to 20 megahertz or so. So it's a trick, but it's a trick that is working well. Then again, a remark to Sergei, I believe there will always be advantages and disadvantages in staying to the analog or moving to the digital. It will depend on the application. For me, the fact that the technology has been made CMOS compliant is opening up an enormous perspective when you have to integrate systems on a chip. So for instance, when you want to go towards LiDAR oriented system where compactness is obviously an advantage, then I believe you will certainly go towards the monolithic. For applications in science, where you want to gain the maximum flexibility, at least initially, possibly you will stay with the hybrid or analog solution.
Okay, thank you very much for the comment.
Thank you.
So thanks again, Gian Maria, for the interesting talk. It was long, it's true, but it was a very complete overview. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We close the seminar here.
Thanks a lot again for the occasion. It was
most welcome. We okay. Keep it up. Thank you. Bye bye.
Sure. See you. Thank you. Goodbye. Bye-bye. Thanks again.
Thank you very much.
Ciao, Gian Maria.